Please welcome to the stage Rene Haas, CEO of Arm, for a conversation with Bloomberg's Tom Giles.
Hey. Rene, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure. Good to be here.
You said that AI has the potential to exceed all the transformative innovations created in the past century, and Arm obviously is uniquely positioned to benefit from this boom. Yesterday, a day after you reported results, or the day you reported results, we saw the stock take a little bit of a hit, all because your forecast for the fiscal year was just shy of kind of where the midpoint of projections was. It reminded me of a couple of days in April when we saw a couple of hardware makers tumble precipitously, because they weren't as exuberant as they had been about growth prospects. And I'm wondering from you, did the market become overly optimistic about the growth prospects for AI and AI infrastructure in particular?
Yeah, well, that's a long question. Let me think about where to attack it first. We did announce our earnings for the year, our fiscal year 23 just ended. We were up 20% year on year. We forecasted for the upcoming year we would be up another 20%, actually north of 20. And then we actually said the year after that we'll be up 20, and then the year after that, 20. So if that's not exuberance, I don't know what is.
Wall Street's hard
market.
To please.
They're hard to please. And we're a semiconductor company in the sense that this is the segment we live in. So we're talking about 20% growth on revenue and 20% growth on profit. There's very few companies that can boast that. Why are we so optimistic about the future? One is the business model. Arm is an IP licensing company, which means that our products are used in just about every single end device you can think of, from a Ring camera to a data center using NVIDIA's Grace Blackwell. But because we are the CPU, the heart of everything, we have incredible visibility in terms of, A, when the products are designed, when they're going to ship, what the volume looks like. So we're very confident about these growth numbers. But to your AI question, AI is that tailwind that's just pushing everyone forward in the hardware space. One of the anecdotes I use is the foundation models, the software, is moving far faster than the hardware. And you just have to look at Gemini Nano, which was introduced late last year, AI agent for smartphones. The smartphones that were designed 2 years ago, they had no idea what Gemini Nano was. So what we're seeing is people investing faster and faster into new hardware, which ends up being a good thing for us.
Equipping data centers, making them more efficient, you've talked about that. Mobile telephony, all of these key to Arm's ability to benefit from AI demand. My question for you is, why not push Arm even closer to the heart of AI chip making by designing an accelerator?
We could. Not talking about products that we haven't leaned forward in terms of unannounced devices. The way I think about the market today is we're doing the IP, and then going forward, we're doing what we call subsystems. That's taking blocks of IP and having them be a finished solution, a GPU, an accelerator, et cetera, et cetera. The next step forward would be doing a bit more than that, maybe something physical. We haven't talked publicly about doing that, but is it in the spectrum of what we could do? Quite possibly.
What are some of the indicators that you're looking for, commitments, conversations from your customers that would give you more comfort in making the plunge and then talking about it?
Yeah, I think it's just getting a sense of this confluence between hardware and software and where the right place to enter in. It's a very, very complex market because it's not only about the chip, but it's about the software, it's about the system, it's about the interconnect. There's a lot involved with it. But because we are at the heart of all these software conversations, because every piece of model runs through Arm in some way, we're pretty close to it. So I think when the time's right, you'll hear about it.
We'll keep hounding you, Rene, on that one. I want to turn to SoftBank, 90% owner. When we've talked to SoftBank in the past about its plans for its stake in Arm, they talked about what a great asset it is, central to SoftBank's AI strategy. We've also reported that Moss is looking to raise as much as $100 billion to bankroll a chip venture that would compete with NVIDIA. Just yesterday, we broke the news that SoftBank's in talks to buy AI chipmaker Graphcore. Can you tell us what your vision is for how ARM complements and fits into SoftBank's seemingly very ambitious plans for AI?
Yeah, well, if you've heard Masa talk, he's been, you know, talking about AI for a long time. The idea of singularity, the idea of AGI, it's something he's quite passionate about. And when he launched the initial Vision Fund back in 2016, 2017, that was really one of the hearts of it. So fast forward to today, I think what you're seeing is just the market now starting to be ready for all that. So he's very, very ambitious in that space. ARM is a very large holding for him, obviously. And back to our earlier chat, we're at the heart of all of these hardware devices, so it's natural that he's pretty bullish on us.
Can you talk about kind of what that complementary role would be in some kind of a large sort of venture like that?
Yeah, I think what you can say is almost any device that he might be looking at on a hardware side or a software side is probably going to run with or through ARM. So understanding what that synergy is, but more importantly, how to accelerate it, I think that's one of the unique attributes that we bring to his portfolio.
I want to drill down a little bit more on smartphones. A lot of interesting cross currents right now. Some of the things that stood out for me, we saw Samsung becoming the top smartphone player globally, dethroning Apple, Xiaomi registering fast shipment growth, Huawei making big advances. Do you anticipate trends like this, gains by Asian smartphone makers in particular, at the expense of one major U.S. smartphone maker? Do you expect that to continue?
I think the geopolitics that we see globally, particularly in China, I think will lead to continued bias towards local brands. I think that's probably not an earth-shattering thing to come out and say. That being said, you know, Apple has a huge footprint in China, so they're not going to cede that ground. I think what we are seeing more broadly is these premium smartphones, whether it's a Samsung Galaxy or some of the Xiaomi devices, we're seeing demand for that sector increase. Combination of people aren't upgrading as frequently, the phones are expensive, and then back to these AI capabilities, which are happening fast, people just want to future-proof.
And talk about the work that you're doing to ensure that those smartphones have the chips that they need in order to accommodate. I mean, we're going to be asking them to do, we ask them to do a lot now. In the future, when we're asking them to, you know, tap into generative AI, for example, a lot more, what's that like? What's that equation like for you?
No, that's a great question, because it allows me to talk a little bit about the way ARM works, because we designed this block of IP, it gets licensed into someone building a chip. That person builds a chip, it goes into a phone, and then it ends up in the marketplace. But actually, we work very closely with the application developers. We work very closely with Google themselves, for example, the Android team, the Gemini team, because actually, it's the software experience running on that processor that is going to define the user experience. So for us, you know, people say, talk to your customer's customer. We're talking to our customer's ecosystem. And that is really sort of central to how ARM works. And that's the case whether we're looking at Android, whether we're looking at iOS, whether we're looking at Windows, Linux, or Linux Automotive. For us, it's really about the software ecosystem and the app developers, because that's what really keys into the hardware.
Just to stay on smartphones for just one more question. As you look into the second half of the year, you talked earlier about demand for premium phones, for example. Overall, how optimistic are you that smartphone demand is going to pick up in the second half of the year?
Yeah, we see the indicators for the premium segment to continue to be pretty strong, so we have confidence on that. And I also think, you know, certain geographies will recover. Units were actually down, you know, for smartphones in general. Premium, not so much. But the good thing for ARM was our royalties were way up, and that's because we've transitioned away from our version 8 architecture to version 9. But more importantly, what does version 9 bring? It brings more compute performance, which is what people are looking for. So I think the market will pick up, though, in the second half.
Thank you. US has set aside $39 billion in grants and other incentives for increasing chip manufacturing, as we all know. What's your assessment of how equitably those funds are being distributed and your prognosis for how successful that effort is going to be in its current form in accomplishing that goal?
Yeah, you know, the CapEx required for these facilities is enormous. And on one level, 33 to 39 billion sounds like a huge number, but when you start to divide it up and divide it up, it's not all that large. I think they did the right thing. I'll be careful, you know, talking to my government oversight here, that, you know, picking between an Intel, a TSMC, a Micron, a Samsung, you know, that's tricky, right, in terms of how to allocate the funding. But I think, broadly speaking, CHIPS Act was the right thing for the United States. The United States has fallen far, far behind in advanced manufacturing, so it's critical to have some type of local capability. So I think, by and large, they got it right. I think the numbers should be bigger. We'll see if there's a CHIP Act too, but I think it's a great start.
Is there discussion around you know, getting a CHIP Act too?
I think there's a belief there's going to need to be. I think one of the challenges you have is that, you know, there could be a change in administration come November, which puts everything up in the air. But I think, broadly speaking, the industry will need more.
If there's a change in the occupant of the White House, politics aside, what are the implications for this effort to boost U.S. competitiveness in this critical area, CHIPS?
I think it's critical for the U.S. to have a leadership position. And in these areas, I know, speaking for whether it's TSMC or Samsung or Intel, this funding is being used for the most advanced fabs, whether it's Intel's 18A in Arizona, or the 3-nanometer that TSMC has in Arizona, or Samsung in Texas. It's all going to the most advanced nodes, which is critical. And also the same thing for Micron, because you can't build these complex chips for AI without advanced memory. So I think the money is going to the right places.
You highlighted in your risk factors for your S1, China took up a lot of space in that. I think we counted the words, and I can't quote them right now, but there was a lot of discussion around US-China, or China versus the rest of the world tension, and what it means for you. Give us a sense, are things any better or than they were when you guys wrote that S1, and how much worse do you think it's going to get if it's not improving?
Yeah, I don't think anybody could write a risk factor section and not include China. And I don't know that the things that Arm worries about are any different than the rest of the industry. Things that come down vis-a-vis export control and of those natures, we obviously comply. But it's difficult to predict what's kind of coming around the corner. I'm an optimist by nature. I'm hopeful that the world can get back to flat again in terms of the technology exchange, but we'll see.
Recently, just to stay on this theme for one more minute, cancellation of licenses for Huawei from Intel and Qualcomm. How concerning is that to you in terms of what it means for your business?
There's no impact to us whatsoever. Those licenses were applied for back in 2020 when Huawei was placed on the entity list. So if you wanted to ship to China, you had to apply for a license that had to be approved. The two companies you named, Intel and Qualcomm, had their licenses approved, so they were able to ship. Now they've been revoked. We didn't apply for anything. We didn't go through that process at all.
But I mean the precedent that we're starting to see, just U.S. restrictions going deeper and deeper down the stack.
I think on that one in particular, probably they were closing a loophole more than anything else. I think the fact that licenses were granted in technology areas that the U.S. has been actively trying to curtail, I view it more that way. I think there was just a loophole that they closed.
Rene Haas, CEO of Arm. Thanks so much for joining us here.
Thank you. My pleasure.